Well, you know, I was almost tempted to just toss my slides today. Based on the last 10 days, this is probably the best informed and most experienced group in the area of national security that I've talked to, certainly at ACSS. And an awful lot of you are directly involved in these processes in your home countries and have personal experience in helping to craft national security strategies and help to develop national security processes. So, I'm not going to give a primer on something you all already know a lot about. So what I am going to do is offer some comments from my perspective on where national security strategy and policy is moving today, not just in Africa, but in the world as a whole, and why that matters for us as security professionals. Some of the things we might want to keep in mind as we undertake these processes. And the first thing I want to observe is, for us, how important national security strategy and policy processes are. You know, there's a lot of focus on the African Union peace and security architecture, on the African standby brigades, with the intent being, gee, we're having a problem generating rapid responses to crises and we need to fix that. And what I would offer is that problem isn't at the AU. That problem isn't at the regional economic communities. That problem really resides within our respective states. And the biggest challenge to rapid and effective crisis response is the challenge of making tough decisions on contentious political issues quickly and implementing those decisions effectively to mobilize resources, move people and equipment, and respond to these crises as they arise. That is all about national security processes. That's one of the reasons this is important. National security processes are evolving very quickly, and one of the reasons is because national security is becoming obsolete in its traditional forms. National security communities globally have not kept up with the evolving threats, something that's become obvious to all of us in the last 10 days. This is a real challenge. The processes of how you craft those strategies and how you implement them need to change in dramatic ways. One of the good news stories here is that they are changing in Africa. In a lot of cases, they're changing in Africa, from what I can see, faster than they're changing in places like the United States and Europe. And I'd offer a couple of things that I've seen as I've worked with national security communities on the continent. There are some features that characterize national security strategy in African states. One of the features is a tendency to have a robust legislative consultative role. In other words, legislatures are getting involved in this. They're getting involved in how those strategies are crafted, what those strategies are designed to accomplish, and hopefully, I hope they're going to become more involved in how those strategies are implemented. That's an important development for reasons that I can talk about more in greater detail in the question and answer if you're interested in that. But I think that's a very, very good development. You don't see nearly that level of legislative involvement on the Western side. In the Western side, national security strategies tend to be very, very centralized, focused inside the executive branch. And I think that Africa really is leading the way to some needed changes in how we approach this process. Okay, another element that I have seen in African approaches to national security strategy is an element of public participation. A great example of this is Malawi. Malawi is in the midst of developing a national security strategy in a public venue for really the first time. One of the things that the government of Malawi did is, in the midst of this process, they took the stakeholders in the process and they went out to various areas around Malawi and they had a robust consultation with local government, with local civil society groups. It was transparent, it was open, and it gives the people a stake in the process and the strategy that traditionally they haven't had before. And I will guarantee you the people do not have that kind of stake in the process here in the United States. In the United States, this process tends to be secretive, non-transparent, very, very centralized in the office of the president. Africa's taken another direction, and it's a direction that I believe is more suited to the new globalized world that we're finding ourselves in. The other thing I've observed about African approaches is they tend to be consensual. They tend to involve lots of stakeholders. They tend to be much more collaborative than an approach that says, where the president says, You, I want you, I'm going to lock you in this room over here. I want you to write that strategy. Show it to me when you're done. The approach that I've seen on the continent tends to be much broader, much more consensual, and I believe produces a much more effective strategy. Let's talk a little bit about why we're doing this in the first place. You know, there was an English work of English literature called Alice in Wonderland. And in this work, Alice is transported to this magical kingdom that she doesn't know anything about. And she finds herself standing at a crossroads with several roads leading in different directions. And there's a resident of this strange land there. And she says to the resident, which road should I take? And the resident says, well, where are you trying to go? And Alice says, well, I don't know where I'm trying to go. I mean, I don't know anything about this place. I'm a stranger. To which the resident replies, then it doesn't much matter which road you take, does it? And Alice says, well, I want to get somewhere. And the resident says, just pick a road and start walking. You are bound to get somewhere. And of course, the question for all of us is that somewhere we want to get to? And one of the other questions is, if you don't know where you are now, it's kind of hard to figure out how you're going to get to someplace else, which leads me to my first comment about national intelligence agencies. National intelligence agencies ought to be about where we are now and helping to inform this whole process of the answer to that question. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the term. National security strategy, national security policy, human security strategy. You'll hear it referred to in a lot of different ways. They all mean the same thing, okay? The British call it a national security policy. Europeans tend to call it a national security policy. Americans and the French, our friends of French, tend to call it a national security strategy. Trust me, it is all the same term. A plug for the Geneva Center for Democratic Control of the Armed Forces. I kid you not, this is the best document I have ever found to put in your pocket. If you get involved in this, if you get involved in the process of crafting a national security strategy or developing a national security strategy, this is the best document I have found. A nice thing to refer to as kind of a context and a framework, and an excellent tool to share with lots of different partners who aren't used to working together and don't necessarily have a common understanding of what a national security strategy or policy is. So I encourage you, if you haven't had a chance to read this, it's on the GlobalNet site in all three languages, and I encourage you to do so. Okay. Important point here, regardless of what you call it, it's not about the document. National security strategy is a process as much as a strategy that you can hold in your hand. And the strategy and the process of developing it can be even more important than the strategy itself. One of the things we find as we begin this process, it strengthens our interagency processes. It gets different stakeholders used to talking to each other. It helps develop a common lexicon. It develops professional networks like this one of public security folks from different agencies, different parts of the government who talk to each other, get to know each other, and that really matters when it comes time to respond to a serious crisis. Okay, whose security are we talking about? This is where we really get into how fast this terrain is changing. Kind of evolving threats meets globalization. It's changing everything. National security is no longer really a national context. Everything about security is globalized. It's transnational. It's linked from local village level all the way up to global level. And you can't separate it into pieces. This is one of the most challenging aspects of developing strategies for national security. We live in an interconnected world where we can no longer craft options and approaches that are localized to our little piece of the world. This is one of the messages when Minister Brownie Samakai, the Liberian Minister of Defense, showed up in Washington about a month and a half ago and went to the White House. His message is, you guys don't get it. Ebola isn't just our problem, it's your problem. And if we don't fix it, it's going to show up on your doorstep. And that is a message for all of us. So one of the challenges here is our context has changed. The context is now sub-regional, regional, international, and within the country, the context is national, intermediate sort of district, state level, and local level. How do you craft a strategy that encompasses that kind of interconnectedness? And how do you craft a strategy when you've got a lot of partners whose actions will impact on that strategy that aren't part of your national security community? Whether they're non-state actors, whether they are donors, whether they are multinational corporations that are involved in exploiting resources within your borders, all of these players influence the process. Most of them are not at our table, but we have to find ways to incorporate them in our strategic processes. Okay, here's the big one, human security. And everybody pays lip service to human security. Everybody does. Oh, yes, it's human security. National security is obsolete. Human security, that's the answer. But none of the folks in our business have really thought this one through. If you really buy human security, how does that change our business? So, okay, let's say that you're going to say public health, environment, education, jobs, infrastructure. These are all security issues. These are all security areas. Okay, I'll buy that. So in your National Security Council, who is the education guy? Who is the public health guy? Who is the jobs guy? Who is the infrastructure guy? What are the new instruments of power that help us implement our strategies? Okay, I mean, I got the military, I got the police. Where are the teacher companies? Where are the public health battalions? Where are the road corps? Okay? We need to answer this one. We need to figure out if human security really matters to us. If we really believe that education, jobs, public health, that they are an integral part of our security architecture, then we, and I don't see a lot of educators out there, and I don't see a lot of public health guys out there. We who are in the public security business right now, we have got to figure out ways to get these new stakeholders to the table in a meaningful sense and figure out what their tools are to influence the national security architecture. Okay, what is strategy? I mean, you all know this. An awful lot of you War College graduates. It's ends, ways, and means. Okay, right, I get that. One of the messages that we try and pound home in our senior service colleges is that ends matter. And at the strategic level, ends matter most. I'll say that again. At the strategic level, ends matter most. What do I mean here? At the tactical level, it's all about ways, right? It's all about how I use what I got. I don't have any influence over the end states or the outcomes, okay? And I typically don't have any influence over my resources. I got what I got. So it's about the ways I use them. At the intermediate level, what we call operational, if you're a military guy, it's about logistics. It's about means. It's about the resources, what kind of resources we develop and how we distribute them. But at the strategic level, it's about what your end states are. Now, you probably, most of you have seen this model. This is the idea that, okay, when ends, ways, and means need to be in balance, okay? The objectives, how you're going to use the means and the means that you have available need to be balanced so that your stool doesn't fall over. And if you craft a set of end states that you don't have the resources, okay, you're Lee and Davis and you're invading Pennsylvania, but your army isn't big enough to win, that's a mismatch. That means you've crafted a strategy that you don't have the means for. So what do you have to do? Well, either I have to change my end state, or I got to find a different way to employ the army that's going to give me an advantage that I don't have now. The mismatch between the three, the imbalance, That's your risk. This is the second place that the intelligence community comes in and plays a huge role. It needs to be able to inform the national security community of what those risks look like. You want to know one of the biggest intelligence failures of the last three decades? Ebola. Where was the CIA 4 months ago? Where was the Liberian Defense Intelligence Service? Okay, where was the national security, the national intelligence? Where were the intelligence organizations in Sierra Leone and Guinea? Where were the intelligence organizations in China and Russia and Europe? Were they thinking about Ebola? No, they weren't. Trust me, they weren't. They missed this one completely. We cannot afford to miss the boat on this one. Not in this new globalized world. The costs are going to be too high. This is why what Miguel is going to talk about is so important. Okay, let me see. National interest. Last thing I want to talk about. The objectives tell you what you care about. And this is something that hopefully you're all grappling with in your papers right now. So the objectives tell us the ends. This is what I want. National interests tell us why I want it. And why is that important? Let me give you an example. I want improved border security. Why do I want that? Because I got cattle rustlers and guys with guns that are shooting my villagers. And oh, by the way, I'm an export economy. My business depends on exports to the country next door. Those goods need to move freely across the border. Well, okay, I'm going to improve border security, but if I improve border security to keep all those bad guys out and make my villagers safer, those measures may not necessarily help the free movement of goods. In fact, they may actually impede it. The measures I impose to make it easier for my companies to move their goods back and forth across the border may place greater risks on my border communities because people are bad guys are able to move back and forth with those goods. So now I need to know those are two national interests, which is more important, which is less important. And when I'm crafting my options, I need to know what those priorities are. This is a model for approaching formulation and national security strategy. It's the model we use in our National War College. Doesn't matter what it is. What matters is you have one, and that everybody who's involved in the process knows what it is and understands how it works. By the way, last comment I'm going to make. By and large, the West isn't going to be very helpful to you in developing national security strategy because they really don't understand your context. That's especially it's true in spades of the Russians and the Chinese. There's an exception to that, and that is my friends the French. Those of you who are looking for a good example of how to approach the process of national security strategy or policy development, the French, beginning in 2007, began a fundamental reappraisal and reform of how they do it. There are some excellent lessons there, and I encourage you to look at the French process. Thank you for your patience, and I'll defer to my friend Miguel.